The name of this video is Method of Images Induction. In the series, in the next few videos, we are going to investigate the important concept and method of images. This method allows us to solve pretty complicated problems, particularly considering conductors in presence of single or multiple point-like charges in space. So when I have one or multiple point-like charges in space nearby conductors with generic shapes, one of the most powerful approaches to solve such a problem is called the method of images. It was invented about 100 years ago, and in the past, before the advent of complicated simulations by means of powerful computers, for example, COMSOL or HFSS simulations, so it's before the development of numerical simulations on classical computers, people started to write entire books with scenarios where the method of images allowed them to solve complicated problems. Even though nowadays we can solve such problems by means of powerful computers, and that's what we do, for example, in my lab and my research all the time to design the samples that we are going to investigate in our experiments, yet the method of images, I believe, is an important concept which you need to understand and know. It also allows us to still make a simple sanity checks to verify whether our simulations were correct or not. In fact, you should do simulations. However, you shouldn't trust them right away. You should always make sanity checks to make sure that those simulations make sense. So this is the context of the method of images. And so in this first video of the next few videos, we revisit the concept of electrostatic induction, which we touched, we've seen in FIS 242. And so to revisit the concept of electrostatic induction, let me restart, for example, with a generic distribution of conductors in space. So this is a set of conductors in space, one conductor, another conductor, etc. And you can have many of them. So let's suppose that all these conductors are fixed in space by means of some forces. So they are fixed in space by means of some forces which keep them in, fixed in their position, and they're characterized by a certain charge each of them. So for example, this one has, usually we do positive with the other color. So let me do this for consistency with previous videos. So they can be characterized by generic charges as always. So this one would be negative, for example, 1, 2, 3, 4, and this one can be charged with a positive charge, and so on and so forth. This one can also be positive, and this one can be negative in this fashion, where this charge, of course, if these conductors are in macroscopic electrostatic equilibrium, can only live on the external surface of such conductors. So these conductors are fixed, and they are characterized by a certain charge. They are also characterized by a certain geometry. All these factors eventually allows us to define an overall sigma, a surface charge density, which for each of these conductors. So we can have, let's call it sigma I, where this one is conductor I equal 1, this is 2, this is 3, this is 4, and we could have more of them. So the fact that they're fixed by means of some forces, their geometry, and the charges which are on them in macroscopic electrostatic equilibrium eventually allow us to set and allow us to determine, to define a precise surface charge density, a sigma I, for each ith of these conductors in space. Now, what happens if we move one of these conductors? Let's say we displace this conductor here by a displacement r. Well, in that case, what happens if I have this displacement r? Well, clearly what happens is that the various sigma i's will change. Okay? And this is due to the fact that, what is the phenomenon behind this change? Think about it for a second, stop, think for a minute about it, and then perhaps reply. Well, they change because of electrostatic induction. As we have seen in 242 already. Okay, one prototypical example, which is very interesting, we already discussed briefly this in 242, is the operative definition of electric field, or electrostatic field in this case. In particular, for example, a very beautiful example is that of a semi-infinite slab of conducting material. So we divide space into two regions. So the region on the right-hand side here, we assume is filled with a conducting material, we call this gamma. So there is a conductor here in macroscopic electrostatic equilibrium, and it's a semi-infinite slab, so it goes all the way to infinite, and we assume that it's uncharged. So there is no charge. Clearly, in this case, we have vacuum here on the left-hand side. What is the electrostatic field E at any point in space, really, for this configuration? Well, obviously, it has to be zero for each point, capital P, in space. And this space, let's define it as omega is the region here on the left, gamma is the conductor on the right, and capital sigma is the surface dividing these two regions of space. So for each point P in the entire space, which is the union of capital omega, capital sigma, and capital gamma, everywhere in space, the field has to be zero because everything is uncharged with vacuum on the left, an uncharged conductor on the right-hand side, of course, the field, the electric field E, has to be zero everywhere in space. Now, what happens if I want to operatively measure such a field? So, according to the operative definition of field, I need to use a test charge. And so the test charge, let's say that is a positive charge, which I locate somewhere here. So this is a positive charge plus Q, which I locate at the point Q naught. It's my test charge. Now, if we use a test charge plus Q to verify, to test what is the electric field, however, we know that the phenomenon, because of the phenomenon of electrostatic induction, this charge plus Q will induce a negative charge, effectively minus Q, which, however, is going to be distributed on the surface of this object. And as we will find out, with a larger distribution closer to the place where the charge is located. So we're going to have a dense distribution of negative charge here, and then it becomes less intense, the charge. As I go away from this charge plus Q, we are going to calculate exactly this in the next few videos. And this overall induced charge is going to be overall a charge minus Q. Okay, equal and opposite to the inducing charge. Total electrostatic induction in this case, that's what we are assuming. So this is the scenario. So we place a test charge to measure a zero field and we induce a negative charge on the surface capital sigma of this conducting object. Therefore, the field is not zero anymore. So because of this, we end up finding a new field E prime, which happens to be different than zero. How can this be? Well, this is obviously an issue which is inherent to the very definition, the operative definition of electric field. So, and this is because, really, of the operative definition . This is the issue, it's right there. And so this operative definition has to be sort of modified in such a way that we want to use a small, whatever that small means. It means you need to be a good experimentalist in order to find how small it is, in order not to perturb your experiment, a small test charge Q. So this is the idea. And how small, again, it depends on your experiment. So in other words, you want to make it small enough so that it doesn't perturb other things you're trying to make in your experiment, okay? So that's the way it works. All right, so in this case, it's very sensitive because we want to measure a zero field. So any charge, even a very small one, perturbs it enough. But in general, it doesn't always have to be that there is a zero charge on the conductor. It could be a charge conductor, in which case you want this small charge Q to be small compared to the charge which is already present on the conductor, so that the effect is small compared to the experiment, to the phenomenon you're trying to observe and measure. All right, so this is really a limiting case, an extreme scenario, worst case scenario, in fact. So now, if I want to be a good experimentalist, I want to know how big is the impact of such a test charge on the experiment I'm trying to do. And so here we can follow a couple of different paths to figure out how big is the impact of a test charge. And let's look at it in this limiting case of an uncharged conductor, which again is the worst case scenario. So how do we proceed to find the effect of this charge plus Q? One approach is the so-called Poisson-Dirichlet problem. So in this case, it's very similar to the Dirichlet problem we've seen in PIS242 when we studied conductors in macroscopic electrostatic equilibrium. In this case, we have in the vacuum region here, there is almost everywhere vacuum, and so whenever there is vacuum, you tend to use the Laplace equation, but in this case, instead of using the Laplace equation, we need to use the Poisson equation because we have a charge right there. And so the Poisson equation in this case reads the scalar Laplacian of V at any point P in space, well, in the region capital omega, which is the vacuum, as I'm about to specify, has to be equal to minus 1 over epsilon naught, the charge density rho in that region. But in this case, I need to use the Dirac delta because I have a point-like charge. And so it's positive, so it's plus Q Dirac delta at point Q naught, which is where I center this charge plus Q. Okay, and so this has to be true for each point capital P in the region capital omega, which is the vacuum region. Poisson equation instead of Laplace. Second, as always, we want that the electrostatic potential V of P has to be a continuous function everywhere in space, that is in this union of capital omega with capital sigma with capital gamma. It has to be always continuous in this case, everywhere in space. And finally, this is still a conductor in macroscopic electrostatic equilibrium. So V of P has to be equal to a constant for each point P on the surface, capital sigma, as well as in the bulk of the conductor itself, which is in macroscopic electrostatic equilibrium. Now, unfortunately, because of the presence of this equation here, which is a Poisson equation with a Dirac delta, this problem happens to be quite complicated. So this is a very hard problem. Eventually, you may study such a problem in a more advanced graduate course level electromagnetism course. Okay, so this is a complicated problem, and maybe one day you will solve it mathematically. However, there is another approach which is much, much simpler to solve the very same problem. This approach is the method of images, which is the topic of the next few videos. So to summarize this video here, this is a very first video about the method of images. So it's an introduction on the concept of induction, electrostatic induction, which we've seen before. So if you have a set of conductors in macroscopic electrostatic equilibrium with a certain charge on them, which are fixed in space and with a certain geometry, all this fixes these surface charge densities on the surface of this conductor. If I move one of them, if I displace it, these charge densities change because of electrostatic induction. The prototypical example is that of an infinite slab, a semi-infinite slab of conducting material, in uncharged, in microscopic electrostatic equilibrium. If I attempt to test zero field, in that case, with a positive test charge Q in front of this conductor, of course, I induce a charge perturbing this this zero field, making it non-zero, which is obviously wrong. And so how to quantify the effect of this charge? We can do by means of the Poisson problem, which is rather complicated because I need to solve this Poisson equation with the Dirac delta. Instead, we will use the method of images. And again, let me reiterate that the key is, in real life, typically this conductor is not uncharged, it's charged, and so you want this Q to be very small compared to whatever is already on this conductor so that it doesn't perturb it significantly. So this is the good experimentalist approach. That's it.